Fall from Grace, written and read by David Ashton. Chapter 1. Inspector James McLevy looked at his shadowy image in the glass of the window. "You are a miserable bugger," he thus addressed the standing figure. Past and through the ghostly outlines of his face, he viewed the city of Edinburgh stretching out before him, the various lights reflecting up into the night sky. For a moment, he thought to see a shooting star far away in the distance, but decided it was a firework left over from bonfire night. Of late, he had taken to prowling the bookstalls of Leith Marketplace, randomly buying anything that caught his eye. His latest haul included some stories by Edgar Allan Poe and a tattered book of Arab legends. Poe had little to offer on shooting stars, but the wise men of the East were of the opinion that these manifestations were firebrands hurled by the angels to keep out the wild spirits of nature, which seek to climb the constellations and peek into heaven. No danger of McLevy climbing any constellation. He didn't have the puff. The inspector crossed to the coal fire where on one side of the hearth a black-encrusted tin coffee pot had its domain, lifted the thing up and shook it gloomily, dry as a bone. And his fourth cup of coffee, some of the grains of which were still lodged in his teeth, had produced no discernible effect on his depression of spirits. As he clattered the pot back down, there was a stirring on the other side of the hearth. Bathsheba opened one yellow eye to gaze at this intruder upon her slumber. A regular visitor of the evening, she would scratch at the window for entry, insinuate her elegant presence, lap up some milk from the saucer, curl up and sleep for a time, then slide back off into the night. McLevy envied her that. He was stuck. She was on the move. A black cat that had crossed his path. "What luck have you ever brought me, eh?" he demanded fiercely. The cat went back to sleep, and McLevy walked back to look down at the small rickety table where the plate from his supper had been shoved aside, and its place taken by a thick ledger of sorts with red covers, which lay open, the white page, staring up at him in mute accusation. To avoid this silent indictment, McLevy concentrated his gaze upon the scrapings of his meal, maiden's hair and dribbly beard, the coarse sinews of the meat boiled into pliant submission, and the water then used to cook the curly kale as a vegetable accompaniment. It was a speciality of his landlady, Mrs. Macpherson, who would hand the steaming mixture over to him at the door as if it were some sort of Dundonian ambrosia. She did, indeed, hail from Bonnie Dundee. He had many memories of that city, few of them happy, and, in fact, he suspected that these dark, submerged hauntings might be more than a contributory factor towards his present malaise. That, and a woman with gypsy eyes. The page still gleamed white. He sighed, sat down and picked up a short, stubby pencil. Other diarists might have quills and parchment. He had a blunt pencil and an old ledger which was a relic from a past case of embezzlement. He was in the habit of jotting down whatever came into his head most evenings. Nothing that would change the fate of humanity, but it would preserve a record of his intuitions and thoughts, perhaps even philosophical musings. One day, he might publish such jottings of sagacity and be hailed as a fountain of wisdom. More likely, he would be laughed out of the Leith police station, so best keep it confidential, for the nonce. In fact, he had kept it so confidential this night he had so far not written a word. Time to unburden, but how to begin? He had read in the Arab book the idea that man was a mixture of the materiality that made up the universe. Well, it was either that or the maiden's hair and dribbly beards. The inspector made his choice. Tongue sticking out from the side of his mouth, head bent close to the paper. It could be his near eyesight was failing, but he wrote anyway. Always the same heading, only the date changed. The Diary of James McLevy, 7th November, 1880. Of all the elements, fire is the least forgiving. Examine hell, for instance. Or take Icarus, flying like an angel till the flame of the sun melted the wax from his wings and sent him plunging through the air, which likewise didn't give a damn, in a downward dive till he hit the ocean and sank like a stone. Water isn't all that merciful either. Come to think of it, Earth is the only one of the four that gives a buddy half a chance. The blessed Earth. We trample it beneath our boots and gouge it like a butcher a dead animal or a surgeon his cadaver. Yet the Earth does its level best to forgive us our sins. A case that began almost a year ago has come to its natural end, and tomorrow we'll see the lid closed. As is often with my pursuits, at times I was like a whirling dervish, and at others a mere bystander as fate rolled out the dice. The result of that throw was to witness a disaster in which all four elements played their parts. The reluctant earth, savage fire, howling wind and ice-cold water. Be that as it may, I shall attain the closing. The lady of the house will be concomitant. There's always a woman to hand. And the devil's never far away either. As long as folk steer the middle course, we may all rest easy, but that rarely happens. Someone, somewhere, high or low, tries to bend occasion to their will without success, and then, to gratify a hunger they barely comprehend, takes a wee step sideways, a deviation, and imperceptibly puts in motion events that set the gates of hell quivering with anticipation. To strive beyond yourself is human aspiration, and yet it is also an item on Satan's breakfast table. Right next to the boiled egg. I should stop now. I fear my thought is moving in a direction that might well land me in the asylum. But why does this vision of Icarus still hold in my mind? Man strains every muscle to rise and embrace that which cradles the seed of his own destruction. An unearthly yowl broke into this meditation. Bathsheba was at the window, ready to embark upon her midnight prowl. McLevy, with a sudden burst of energy, leapt up, pulled up the sill to let her depart, and then leant his head out to follow her progress. He watched as she padded along the damp slates and then slipped out of sight. A strange cheerfulness unexpectedly possessed him, as if he had left his gloom upon the page. James McLevy, inspector of police, would attack his next investigation with appropriate ferocity. Crime was the blood in his veins. He looked once more over his city, Edinburgh, and somewhere towards the sea, the parish of Leith, his patch, where he was king of the castle. The cold November air stung at McLevy's face as he let out a whoop of laughter that echoed in the still night. Chapter 2. Mary Ruff looked grimly into the flame of the oil lamp as she listened to her son thrashing around in the recesses of the warehouse. Noise enough to waken the dead, or, more to her concern, a distant night watchman walking the Leith docks. It had been a big mistake to let that boy near whiskey, but his nerves needed steadying. The great gawk and a rinse of kill-me-deadly was all that would do the trick. Unfortunately, it also gave Daniel Ruff the illusion that he was ruler of the world, and in addition, as is so often the result of whiskey, brought out the cantankerous side of his nature. Not that it needed much bringing out. He would take issue with his own shadow. But in drink, Daniel would beat that shadow to the ground and stamp it to death with his big, hobnailed boot. Many was the time Mary had witnessed him crashing his foot down with enough force to raise sparks from the stone as he tried to destroy the fiend below. There are 7 kinds of beastly drunk. Swine, who sleeps and pukes, sheep, who cannot speak, marten, who drinks himself back sober, goat, who is lascivious, fox, who is crafty, ape, who leaps and sings, and lion, who is quarrelsome. Daniel was a combination of ape and lion. It was Mary's own fault she had spoiled him as a wee boy because of his infirmity, and now as a huge man he still bore the imprint of that indulgence. His hulking form emerged from the shadows as he dragged out some large freight cases, still marked with the name of the ship, the Dorabella, which he began to pile up in the middle of the floor, whilst singing jaggedly under his breath. Wee willy wanky, runs through the turn, upstairs, downstairs in his nightgown. It is doubtful if Daniel knew that in some Jacobite songs, Willy Winky was supposedly the nickname of William the Third, but he crashed the last wooden crate into position to compensate for any lack of learning and let out a bellow which echoed on and on in the emptiness of the building.
Mummy, I have it all in hand. Bring me my tools of trade.
Can you no be quiet? She admonished. Do you want the world to know?
A wild laugh came in response. The whiskey may have calmed his nerves for a while, but now they were breaking loose again. It was always so when he came to this point, for he both loved and feared the fire. It was a large warehouse, piled high with packing cases, all wooden, all grist to the mill. The ceiling was high and vaulted, a good updraft and plenty of gaps in the walls for the wind to whistle in and fan the flames. Mary noted all this with a keen eye as she crossed towards him, carrying the lamp in one hand and a large sack which she bore, lightly enough, in the other. The light from the lamp caught Daniel's shadow and threw it in grotesque against the assembled pile as he capered round it, dragging his twisted right foot behind like a horse would haul a ploughshare through stony earth. His infirmity. It had twisted his nature as well. Daniel snatched at the sack and emptied it out, shaking a thick mass of wood shavings onto the floor, and then scraped them round the heaped cases with his warped, misshapen foot, giggling like an uncontrollable child. "What's so funny?" asked Mary, who was growing increasingly nervous. The sooner they were out of the place, the better. She had a bad feeling, which was getting worse by the second, not helped by the fact that she had failed to move her bowels all day and was dying to sit on a midnight khaki pot. Daniel bent over and blew playfully at some shavings to propel them like a snowdrift towards the bottom of his created edifice. Then he straightened up and recited a fragment of what was swirling through his mind.
"Assist to the joiner, Phil. Can I have these shavings, kind sir?" Says he, "What for?" Says I, "They start a fine fire."
He laughed at that. And then a following thought not so pleasant struck him.
"The old bugger even wanted payment. Is there any charity in this thieving bastard world?"
His face suddenly contorted in anger, and he produced a heavy hammer from the inside depths of his jacket to bring it crashing down repeatedly on the lid of one of the cases.
"So I give him this blow, and then I give him another."
"You're a liar," said Mary. "You gave him the payment."
Daniel ignored this shaft of mother wit and dashed his hammer down on the dislodged lid, breaking it into pieces which he added to the accumulation.
"You don't need it all," she remonstrated. "This place is dry as a bone. It'll go up like the flames of hell."
Again he paid no attention, and his manic burst of energy, far from exhausted, shoved the hammer back into his pocket, then delved into the contents of the broken case, emerging with a small, square box, which he opened up and sniffed in apparent ecstasy.
"Stinkodoros, ripe and ready." "Don't touch the merchandise," came the sharp warning, but Daniel in response bawled out like a market trader.
"Best quality, dozen in a box."
"Quiet and down, for the love of Christ."
He bowed his head in seeming contrition, meekly closed the lid, handed the box over to Mary's keeping, and then signalled for the lamp.
"I'll do it," said Mary.
"Give it me."
"You're no in control.
Give it me."
There was a drunken, evil glare in his eye that frightened her. Mother or not, she sometimes wondered if one sweet day her darling son would split the maternal skull with his big, fine hammer. She handed over the lamp. He snuffed out the wick, leaving them both in complete darkness. Then he swung the vessel round to release the oil, which spattered over the heap of shavings and wood, laughing wildly as some of the fluid landed and slid like mucus all down his front.
"A wee like here, a wee like there,
Ach, the whole damn thing.
There was a crash of breaking metal and glass as he hurled the lamp to shatter on the sharp edge of the crate.
What's your body now?
Mary called out in the pitch black surrounding her, an edge of panic in her tone. She had a superstitious terror of the dark, always slept with a candle by the bed lest night demons come to steal her soul for his satanic majesty. Daniel fumbled in his pocket for a lucifer, which was then struck up to illuminate his sweaty, distorted face, eyes bulging in the sudden light.
This place will fire like a tinderbox,
she warned, moving back to safe distance, while she could still see.
And I'm just a boy to do it, said Daniel with pride.
But as he moved towards the pile, his boot crunched on a shard of glass, and he staggered slightly.
For Christ's good sake, guard yourself, Mary hissed,
shoving the box that he had given her inside the deep pocket of her old coat, a souvenir from the time when she had once been a shoplifter of high repute.
Ach, it's my bad foot, mammy,
came the derisive, muffled response. Daniel bent over, cupping the lucifer in hand. Now it was time. Now would see his fear go up in smoke. He crooned some more of the song, giving the words a sinister lilt.
Tilling at the window, crying at the lock of the winds in their bed, for now it's 10 o'clock.
For a moment, time stood still. Then tragedy, which had been biding its occasion in the shadows, made a dire and purposeful entrance. As Daniel dropped the lucifer on the shavings, they flared into life, leaping up like a tiger from ambush, and found a sympathetic response from the oil spilled on his trousers and coat. He howled in pain, lost his footing, and fell forward onto a blaze of his own creation as the rest of the dry tinder exultantly joined the conflagration.
In a matter of seconds, a wall of flame had formed a barrier between the horrified Mary and her combustible son. She could hear his screams and reached out her arms helplessly to call his name as he burned like a pillar of fire. But he led no tribe towards the promised land. The fear that had always haunted him had been well founded. The fire had claimed him, embraced him, like a loving father, and was teaching its child the secrets of white heat. His shrieks of agony rang in Mary's ears as the flames leapt towards her, seeking out another convert to the cause.
Chapter 3. Dean Village, 8th November, 1880. Margaret Bouch watched on as her husband's coffin was lowered into the ground. The ropes held, and it went smoothly enough into the appointed slot. She blinked a little as the icy, slanting November rain, which had swept across Dean Cemetery from the moment the pitifully small cortege had entered the gate, stung her face through the black veil, in retribution for tears unshed. She recollected that as a child, funerals had always provoked in her a perverse desire to cock a snoot, to whirl a mad cartwheel.
heels in the air, petticoats are flying, to scandalize the moon faces of the mourners with flesh and bone. What if she did now? She pondered to herself. What if she ripped the dripping bonnet from her recently widowed head, flipped it neatly to join the lumps of earth already falling on the coffin lid as the ropes were hauled out of the grave, and called aloud, "I'll dance the hornpipe with the sailor boys tonight. How does that recommend itself unto you, Sir Thomas, my darling one?" Perhaps not. Was a decision. Save it for another day. Margaret looked across to where their three children, all grown, now huddled together under a weeping umbrella. Her son's pale face was set in stone and manly forbearance. Everyone thought him an absolute brick. And who was she to disagree? He had accompanied them every day to the court of inquiry, and they had both watched as his father's proud facade cracked like the very bridge itself. Every day she had observed Sir Thomas ignore her and lean more and more heavily upon the filial arm as the clouds of shame and disgrace gathered above his head. And then they had burst. As she brought this to mind, another squall of rain hit her through the veil, the sudden violence driving some of the mourners back from the edge of the grave. But Margaret Bouch stood firm. She was the widow, after all. Widows don't give an inch. The minister droned on. Something about the kingdom of heaven, how to get there. Surely a better to quote from the psalm, "Praise the Lord upon earth, ye dragons and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and vapours, wind and storm fulfilling his word." Praise the Lord indeed, was her unhallowed thought. He had shown no mercy that dreadful night, towards the last year's end. Nor, in Margaret's experience, had he ever demonstrated much inclination towards clemency upon earth. The Reverend Jeremiah Snedden of the Episcopalian Church of Scotland, a man, in her opinion, who more than lived up to his name, had insisted upon being bareheaded, and his wispy white hair plastered to his skull had left him to look like a monkey caught out in the rain. Margaret had a quick glance round to make sure no one was aware of these profane contemplations, but she was safe behind the veil. What a dreadful woman she was, to be sure. Last night had she not drunk of strong whisky, and more than one glass? In the morning she had noticed her fingers tremble as she donned the widow's weeds. She fumbled for her handkerchief slyly, raised her hand under the damp veil as if touching the cloth to her face, breathed out, and sniffed. No, not a trace. A faint redolence only of violets from the lozenges sucked so assiduously after her toilette that very morning. Toilette, Margaret reflected. Now there's a respectable word, for was she not a respectable lady? She felt as if her husband had been an iron band around her body, and now, free of its constraint, she was shaking to pieces as the train roared overhead. Margaret shivered. One of the newspapers had, as its front page,
An artist's impression of the calamity, men, women, and children falling into the bleak December sea like so many brittle leaves. Although, almost a year ago, she could not rid her mind of that image. And what of Sir Thomas, she wondered. What pictures were frozen inside the cold obstruction of his mind? She had experienced an impersonal kind of compassion for the man, despite the secrets he had concealed. A dutiful pity. But he had shut her from his life and locked her out like a poor beast in the rain. Year by year, the little wife had withered and dwindled while he and his true love kissed and fondled to heart's content. Now, Mistress Bouch was free. Free to destroy herself in any way she saw fit. The minister closed his Bible with a dull, righteous thud, and Margaret became conscious that she was the focus of many eyes. For a moment, she was confused, then remembered the protocol of interment. The widow, now down, groped for a portion of the damp, sodden earth and cast it into the grave before her. The muddy mass landed on the polished oaken lid and stuck to one of the brass fittings, then slowly slid out of sight towards oblivion. She hoped, sincerely, that would do the trick. And it did. She watched the others follow suit, the rain herding in their thrown clods like a drover, and then the pallbearers began to drift away, just like her mind. Margaret had felt such a welcome separation from reality since her lord and master had died, and prayed most earnestly for its continuance. In the meantime, all ceremonies were to be observed, and she would play her part. They would all reconvene at the house in Bernard Street, a little too near the Leith docks for some, but Sir Thomas had it purchased as his base in Edinburgh because he liked to walk to the sea and gaze upon that which he planned to conquer. Reconvene. She could just see it now. Tasteful funeral meats would be passed from hand to hand, malt whiskey raised to lips, not the grieving widow's, of course, and then, after a respectful time, the mourners would take their pious departure, surreptitiously scraping heels on the curbing stone outside, lest some oozing stigma had attached itself to their shoes along with the earth from the cemetery. Margaret became aware that a man was standing before her, muttering words of comfort she could scarcely hear. Such was the blessed separation. A fellow engineer to her husband, bound by professional code to attend. A few of these, the family, and that was all Sir Thomas had, to see him on his journey. Not much of a show, to be sure, but then the bridge builder had few intimates. Certainly not her. No, few intimates save the one. She brought his face to mind. Alan Telfer, his personal secretary, who scarcely bothered to conceal the look of cold disdain in his eyes if she dared to visit Edinburgh and disturb them at their work. This stupid, interfering woman, this dowdy, squashed creature who witnessed them with their heads together over the sacred drawings. A fine combination. But Mr. Alan Telfer was missing from the scene. due to the undisputed fact that he had, some time ago, blown out his brains. Quel dommage. So regrettable. A dreadful sight, to be sure, she remembered. She had borne witness to so many things. In truth, there were two participants missing from the scene. Where, she wondered, was the other? A gust of wind blasted the rain almost horizontally into the face of Reverend Snedden, and the man of God moved hastily to follow the straggle of departing mourners towards the waiting carriages. He left a space where piety had endured, and through that frame passed the attendant gravediggers who stood patiently biding the time to begin their labour. Margaret saw a shrouded figure in the distance under a threadbare, dripping tree. The inspector. He had come after all. How like the man. Chapter 4. As for James McLevy, his mind went back to when it had all begun. 1 year before. Leith, December 1879. Murder is a dirty business. The corpse of the old man lay in a dismal posture on the stone flags of the scullery floor where it had fallen. Body wrapped in a heavy outdoor coat, the blue serge still damp from last night's rain. An apologetic little dribble of blood led from the crushed head at the foot of the stairs where the fellow had rested quietly enough until assailed by the shriek of a hysterical kitchen maid who had arrived at the crack of dawn to help prepare breakfast. Indeed, some ham and a slab of liver fresh brought that morning from the butcher's were huddled together on a plate near the sink where the selfsame maid, who had entered from the side door, had dumped them down before turning to discover the carnage lurking behind. The liver also bore traces of blood, though McLevy doubted if it would receive the requisite cleansing. He also doubted that, even if treated so and fried up with some onions and the ham, there would be much appetite in the house. Nothing tempers the carnal like a cadaver, unless you're a policeman. Constable Mulholland was upstairs, exercising his Irish charm on the maid, who was a hefty specimen, one of these glandular females that the inspector avoided like the plague. Mulholland, however, was good with glands. McLevy was left with the dead butler. The inspector had painstakingly scrutinised the floor's slabs down to the very cracks. Just under the man's skull he had found fragments of flesh and bone. Difficult to tell whether they had spilled out after the head had been split and he had fallen, or if they were the result of the fall itself. But from the depth of the wound he would have to assume a blow. A savage blow. He then poked into the myriad moist crevices of the scullery, but found nothing untoward. A few cockroaches scuttled guiltily into hiding, but they undoubtedly had an alibi. He remembered reading once in one of his books the fact that cockroaches were revered in ancient Egypt. A mysterious bunch, the Egyptians. It would seem as if entry had been forced by the jemmying open of one of the windows at the back garden, which provided access to the lower ground floor level where the kitchen and scullery were based. The question was, had the fellow been on his way in to commit the robbery when he encountered the butler, or had he already committed it and been on his way out? The inspector fervently hoped the latter. If nothing had been taken, then nothing could be traced, and that would shut off a fertile source of inquiry, because in McLevy's experience, the pawn shops in certain low areas of Leith were veritable mines of information, and he knew how to dig up the load of crime therein, pick and shovel. There were some scrapes down the stone steps which suggested that the old fellow may well have been struck at the top wheel landing where the door led out into the hall and then fallen like a shot crow. Minute examination of these steps in turn had yielded nothing. Servant's skeleton cracked open, that was obvious enough, but the murder implement was nowhere to be seen, nor was the murderer. Not a clue. What a pity. He leant over and looked into the sightless eyes of the corpse. The old man's skin was stretched tightly over high cheekbones, the sockets above them deep and hollow, lips drawn back over the teeth as if the butler had sucked in death from a silver cup. "I don't suppose Archie," he said, having been reliably informed that the man's name was Archibald Gurley, "I don't suppose you might pass me a description of your assailant." No answer was forthcoming, but McLevy persisted. "Anything that might help, no matter how small. Rack your brains, sir. However, the aforementioned brains had a chasm bashed into them, leaving the head looking like an indented round of cheese, and," with a sigh, the inspector brought the one-sided conversation to an end by pulling up gently a blanket which had been laid on the body to cover the bewildered, frightened face, then made his way up the stairs to search out some live members of the household. He emerged into the narrow, gloomy hall, with a high, pale, consumptive ceiling, which did nothing to dispel the claustrophobia always induced in McLevy by the trappings of middle-class decorum. Queen Victoria would have been proud of this hallway. It was a testament to her glorious reign, the epitome of denied joy. A little grudging natural light came through the cold blue and green stained glass window above the heavy street door, to be absorbed by the brown, mottled walls. A dark, knobbly umbrella stand was on sentry duty at the entrance, and halfway down the thin corridor jutted a small table, a wooden, bare, upright chair at each side, and a vase set on a white doily, precisely in the middle of the table surface. The edges of the lace doily were curled up slightly as if retracting from the general murk, and the vase, as far as he could see, was empty, unless it contained the ashes of some ancestor. Could be. It was a bilious, pale yellow colour that might possibly indicate the funereal pallor of a long-dead relative. McLevy hesitated. All the doors were closed, and he had but a hazy notion of the geography of the house, having been conducted straight to the murder scene. He could hear the murmur of Mulholland's voice from somewhere off to the side and a smothered, high-pitched response as the girl tried to gulp down her sobs and talk at the same time.
Yeah, now we had a situation. The constable and maid were closeted in the small parlour, and this door against which he now pressed his ear must be for the main drawing room. There's no getting away from it, the inspector thought. He was a terrible, nosy man. A Jean Brash, the premier madam of the best body house in Edinburgh, the Just Land, had many times remarked that if you gave McLevy heaven, he would want hell along with it, in case he missed out on something. It was time he should visit Jean Brash. She made the best cup of coffee in Edinburgh. A Lebanese grinding. Now, was that more sobbing he heard through the panel? But not in a high note, more like a low, choked swallow of regret. On an impulse, he did not knock, but silently turned the handle and slid into the chamber like a ghost.
Chapter 5. A woman stood in the centre of the room, her head bowed. A stray shaft of greyish light from the dark curtained window catching at her figure like a child its mother's skirts. McLevy observed the scene silently, and after a moment she sensed his presence and lifted up a smooth, white face, unstained by tears, the skin almost translucent, like a pearl. The lady of the house. He had briefly glimpsed her as the secretary, Alan Telfer, had ushered him downstairs to make acquaintance with the corpse. Wife of Sir Thomas Bouch, Margaret by name. "Well, Maggie," he wondered to himself, "your eyes are dry enough, but what haunts you this day?" She was a petite woman, high cheekbones and above them the aforesaid eyes, surprisingly dark and slanted, gypsy fashion, with dark eyebrows arching above like lightning conductors. A compact little body, contained and corseted, the feet deft and dainty. McLevy was a great observer of women's feet and what covered their nakedness. These small boots, elastic-sided, peeping shyly out from below the dark, severe hem of her dress, though in black leather to match her raven hair with its austere middle parting, was surprisingly possessed of pointed toes. Not snubbed in rectitude, but pointing, straight as a die, at him. Now, there's a thing. Nothing betrayed character like shoes. His own were solid and serviceable, but that was a disguise like the rest of him, and he lived in terror of the day that someone would rip the mask away and reveal him in the light. When she spoke, her voice was musical enough, but in a minor key, muted. Nothing percussive. "How may I help you, Inspector?" She seemed in no way perturbed that he had popped up in front of her with no word of warning. Nothing glandular here. And yet he sensed something. What was it? A vixen bites through her own flesh to escape the wire of the snare? He must stop drinking so much coffee. It provoked his intuition to hallucinatory extremes. Back to terra firma.
"Well, I'm hoping you can, Mrs. Bouch."
"It is my fervent wish."
"Fire away."
McLevy nodded, but his mind was busy with the last two words. Perhaps her father had been a sharpshooter.
Archibald Gourley, he ventured.
The poor creature.
The corpse. What were his habits?
Habits?
They may have led him to his death. You see, I need to know them. I need to know his life.
But surely, by accident, he chanced upon a thief and suffered death.
I'm not a great believer in accident.
For a moment her eyes drifted away, and McLevy glanced round the chamber. The walls were a drab olive green, hung with various photographs of bridges, ferry boats and trains, mostly decked out in the claret and cream colours of the North British Railway Company. Indeed, the whole aspect reminded him greatly of a waiting room in a railway station. Perhaps not surprising, given Sir Thomas Bouch and his connections, but in the dark, square, masculine furniture, which lined up against the wall like soldiers, there was not a trace to be found of femininity, not a frill to the antimacassar. An empty space that people passed through, en route to another destination. Margaret Bouch spoke slowly, her attention fixed inwardly, as if to hold some emotion at bay. Mr. Gourley had been butler here these past 10 years. He managed this household to perfection.
Like a railway timetable? McLevy asked, a wicked gleam lurking somewhere at the back of his eyes.
Precisely so. He was a kind, gentle old man who lived to serve.
And died, no doubt, in the same capacity, muttered the inspector. Or of his desires?
Desires?
We all have them.
McLevy's remark caused the woman to blink. He was somewhat amused by that. No doubt her acquaintance of policemen was slight. The occasional overbearing chief constable at official functions, and the inspector did not correspond to any known specification. No fixed abode.
I never asked him, she replied somewhat primly.
That's the trouble with being a servant, McLevy frowned as if personally affronted. Nobody ever asks you.
He noted a flash of outrage in her eyes. Good.
Let us therefore leave desires and return to habit, he said. Of a Wednesday evening, what was his custom?
It was his night off. He would go and have a few drams with his old friends. A wee gab in the corner of the old ship, he would say. He loved to gossip.
She said a passable imitation of an old man's voice, and McLevy noted that also a talent for mimicry was rare in a woman of this class, and more especially absent was the willingness to display such a gift. The old chap, he said. I know that tavern well. A good place for a wee dram.
His tone was warm enough, but his eyes were watchful.
Old friends together, eh? He thought to himself.
The mistress and the servant.
And he told you so? He confided that much in you?
Yes, but not the extent of his desires, she replied dryly. Not what he wished for. In his heart.
Peace and quiet, probably, said the inspector a trifle sententiously. Well, he's found it now.
Can murder bring you peace and quiet? She bit the words off somewhat tightly, and McLevy was happy enough inside himself. Getting the truth out of the respectable classes was a fiendish job, and you had to catch them on the hip, or was it the hop?
And when did he usually get back at night?
Late, and sometimes
slightly the worse for wear, I often heard the key scraping in the lock. Affection in the voice, but the inspector had picked up on something else. Ye heard? Late at night? So, if I may ask Mistress Bouch to be alert so deep into the dark. I sleep badly. So do I, said the inspector. I put it down to conscience. He smiled at her, like a wolf in a nursery book illustration, not chasing after Red Riding Hood or three smallish pigs, just a wolf in a green field with all the time in the world. He often regarded himself so, and Margaret Bouch did not seem at all uncomfortable with this prospect. Perhaps she was part wolf herself, thought McLevy. So did you hear a scrape last night, he continued, or something else, perchance? I was not here last night. The inspector raised his eyebrows the merest fraction, and his mouth drooped slightly like a puzzled child. It was what Mulholland would recognise as McLevy's idiot look, and often drew a response like a poultice. This is my husband's place of work, his office and study are set here on Bernard Street. The family home, his country retreat, is in Moffat. That's border folk, said McLevy. Sheep stealers and the like. He laughed loudly. She permitted herself a faint smile at this presumed witticism, but had Mulholland been on hand, his long nose would have twitched in recognition that the inspector was up to his tricks. A fair distance, McLevy's eyes widened at the thought. Back and forwards all the time, eh? Sir Thomas spends his week on the premises here, and then at weekends he does not, he returns. To the bosom of his family. That is correct. She responded evenly. And you, Mistress Bouch? I reside there. The Moffat house demands much of my attention. But it didn't in former times, did it? I beg your pardon. Because, as you told me yourself, you'd lie awake in this place at night and listen to the key scraping in the lock. For a moment she did not answer, and in the silence a ship's horn from the Leith dock sounded in the distance like a lost soul. That is correct. In former times. Yet here you are today. McLevy beamed at her as if they had both reached a satisfactory conclusion to the exchange, and Margaret Bouch shook her head as if it was spinning a little. I had some shopping to do in Edinburgh, and took our carriage, which we have a carriage, you see, and arrived in the early morning to find this catastrophe. That would mean, the inspector surmised, she had left Moffat before the break of dawn. Why such an hour? Was her arrival unannounced? Unexpected, what had she hoped to find, a house full of licentious women? Under his scrutiny, Margaret Bouch suddenly pushed forward one of her dainty boots with the toe pointing up towards the ceiling. It was like a gesture of defiance. I dare say you would like to talk to my husband about all this, Inspector.
I dare say I would.
Then let me oblige you, she said, walked to the study door, knocked sharply upon it, then thrust it open.
Chapter 6. Dean Village, 8th November, 1880. McLevy watched as Margaret Bouch picked her way down the curving cemetery path, a slight figure cutting through the rain like a shark's fin. Everyone else had quit the brow of the hill, save for three figures under a black umbrella, observing her passage. The fates, perhaps. Best keep eyes peeled for Atropos, the one who brandished the scissors for cutting the thread of life. Or was that who was on the approach? These 11 months ago, when she had opened the door to disclose her husband and his private secretary, the men had been bowed, heads together over the drawings of a projected crossing for the Firth of Forth, the foundation stone of which had already been laid. It was an undertaking which would make Boucher's previous achievement, the Tay Bridge, seem like mere child's play. A panoramic photograph of that same bridge, upon the wall behind his desk, had towered above them all, taken on a sunny day. The images and conversation of the encounter raced through McLevy's mind as he watched the widow walk towards him. A figure flickered before his vision like a magic lantern show as a shaft of pale, ruined sunlight broke through the clouds for a brief moment to light up the sheets of heavy, driven raindrops. Sir Thomas Bouch had been bearded, his eyes wide set, face impassive, the grey hair at the side of his head rising like cherub's wings. He had, to his credit, 300 designed miles of railway track and had built more bridges than any man of or in his age. Flying high. Alan Telfer shaved close. A thin face, pale eyes. In the Vatican, he would have been private secretary to one of the Monsignors, carrying mysteries inside a scarlet sleeve. There was also a military air to him, a straight back, hinting at generations who had rushed into the cannon's mouth to die for king and country. Here, his fanaticism had fixed itself upon one object only. Both men seemed oddly uninterested in the murder, as if it had happened in China. They had been asleep, heard nothing, and would be grateful when this disturbance was over. There was much work to be done. McLevy had been conscious of undercurrents as deep and treacherous as the winter confluence of the River Tay itself. Dark forces swirling over a bed of mud, sand and stone. When Telfer had suggested that the old man had in some way provoked the inconvenience of his own death by blundering in the worse for drink and grappling with the intruder instead of raising the alarm, Margaret Bouch drew in her breath as if struck to the core. Seeing McLevy register this, the secretary, with a sideways flick of a glance and a faint, dismissive smile, consigned such reactions to female irrationality and misplaced emotions. Her response had been a sudden gleam of hatred in the dark eyes, which then disappeared like lightning, swallowed up in a storm. Sir Thomas, on the other hand, had seemed to have no emotions at all. His whole being appeared to have withdrawn to a loftier plane where great enterprises were being structured in the high reaches of his mind. All grist to the mill. A comical aspect had been unwittingly added to the situation when Mulholland joined the party, all five crammed within the small, airless study. The constable stood beside Margaret Bouch, nearly 1.5 feet of height between them. And for a second there was a glint of humour in her eyes as she stared up at the lanky frame of Mulholland before she met McLevy's gaze and schooled her features back to dutiful serenity. A blast of rain in his face brought McLevy back to the present moment. Perhaps he should walk up the cemetery path to meet the woman halfway. That's what a gentleman would do. But would a gentleman be lurking under a tree in the first place? Better stand his ground. Back to the grist. The maid had contributed little save an ill-disguised desire to find further acquaintance with the constable in an unofficial setting. But Mulholland was somewhat sniffy about romance with kitchen maids. When McLevy had asked the company if anything was missing from the house to support the idea of a possible burglary, and also perhaps provide him with something more positive to go on than an uncommunicative corpse, Alan Telfer assured him that everything was in place. It would seem that the investigation, hardly yet begun, was deadlocked. However, the inspector had remarked upon something. Arranged on a long shelf running along the side of the study were the various awards and plaques that Sir Thomas had garnered during his so far meteoric career. Not at all a prideful display, the shelf somewhat tucked away in a recess, but the arrangement was disposed in orderly fashion, and the inspector's sharp eye had noticed a gap in the assembly. When he had brought it to the man's attention, Telfer was on a bound to agree. A silver candlestick, part of the gifts bestowed upon Sir Thomas when given the freedom of the ancient borough of Dundee, it was missing. No longer to hand, an oversight on the secretary's part. Had it by any chance been inscribed? Oh, indeed, sir. 31st of May, 1878, to Sir Thomas Bouch from the Grateful Burghers of Dundee. The inspector's first clue. He had not known then that it would lead him eventually to the mouth of hell. A voice broke in on these ramblings. "You might have joined us on the hill," said the lady of the house. Margaret was now standing in front of him, and though garbed for deep mourning, was fashionably enough sculpted into her attire, the tiny waist, a dimension with which he had been granted some unexpected experience, accentuated by the sweep of her coat. She looked like a little doll, all dressed up for the funeral, bearing the weeds patiently enough, but dying for a change of costume. She would be the dancing lady to McLevy's hardy tin soldier, both perishing in the flames.
"I prefer to observe from distance," he replied.
"From distance. How like the thing." She crooked her elbow and laid right hand upon her waist in an oddly provocative gesture. Behind the veil that hung from her daintily perched hat, the gypsy eyes looked him up and looked him down behind the veil.
"You resemble a beekeeper," he remarked.
She laughed suddenly, but there was a harsh edge. So much unspoken, she thought. So much water under the bridge. For instance, a moment in a room in Moffat when he had jammed his hat upon his head and ran for dear life. Yet why was he here? Margaret wondered. Hope springs eternal. With a swift, incisive gesture, she threw back the veil to reveal her face. High cheekbones, marble white amid the November gloom in a landscape of tombstones. And you look like... She began. Margaret collected and arranged her impressions, as if seeing him for the first time. A heavy-set man with thick, stubby arms, the hands small and strangely feminine, possessed a grace of movement that contrasted with the rest of his constitution. The legs short, the feet small also, but planted firmly to the ground. A somewhat comical assemblage until encountering the face. The lupine, slate-grey eyes pierced a hole through to find the most secret, shameful thoughts. Behind the flesh of his cheeks, hard bone, chiselled by the east wind. The mouth was curiously shaped, pouting almost. He wore a dark blue topcoat, collar turned up against the rein, and a low-brimmed bowler which sat somewhat uneasily on the wiry pepper-and-salt hair. His skin was parchment white, as if the sun had never troubled its surface. "You look like an undertaker," she concluded. "I'm in the right place, then." A sudden blast of wind and rain swept in upon them, and she seemed to lose her balance, toppling towards him. His hands reached out to take her by the elbows, then arrested their motion. She regained her equilibrium close to his chest and lifted her face. The drips from the brim of his bowler fell onto her cheeks and chin. Her tongue reached out to savour one. She let the liquid linger upon that fleshly organ and then swallowed.
"I have come to say goodbye," McLevy announced,
his voice somewhat hoarse, but he blamed it on the weather. "Then say it."
"Goodbye, Mistress Bulch. The case is over."
She laughed into the teeth of the wind, turned abruptly, pulled down her veil and marched off and back up the hill to where the Fury still stood and waited under the umbrella. McLevy felt an emptiness inside. But he could fill that up with coffee.
Chapter 7
Mulholland gazed with some admiration at his reflection in the cracked mirror. It was a trifle distorted, but beauty is forever in the eye of the beholder. Love makes a fool of us all, and the constable was no exception to that rule. Therefore, he gazed fondly at his own image. Who could not fail but be impressed by the sincerity in his clear blue eyes, light brown hair neatly parted to the side, and skin like a milk cow? "Profile now," he turned to observe Sam. A trifle sharp in the feature, but had his own Aunt Katie not often remarked that her nephew had the sideways apparition of a Roman emperor? Mind you, Mulholland wasn't so sure about that assertion. The ones he'd witnessed in the Museum of Antiquities seemed to have badly broken noses, and his own was straight as a Presbyterian pew. There was also, of course, the Romanish aspect to be taken into consideration. To be sure, he knew Aunt Katie was referring to the ancient empire rather than the Pope's tiara, but still it left an uneasy, swampy feeling, like a cloud of incense. Back to the nose. It's a bit long, maybe, but was there not a saying amongst the vulgar sort that a man with a long neb and big feet had much to offer in other departments? Not that he would ever dream of boasting about the primal parts, but he was satisfied from boyhood comparisons with some pig farmer's sons at the back of the barn that he could more than hold his own. His eyes glazed over as he dreamed of a divine consummation. He and his beloved like swans on the river, above them blue skies and below clear water. However, into these sacred visions of the fragrant Emily slid a depiction that, if not downright voluptuous, brought a definite tingle to the constable's loins. She lay on the marital bed, a four-poster with dark velvet curtains and lashings of moonlight. Her nightgown was chaste enough, white as purity, with frilly bits, but her lips were moist and parted, breath on the short side. The pupils of the eyes dilated with anticipation. He was standing beside the plumped-up pillows, also in a nightgown, not quite as white, smiling down at her. Any manifestation of desire well hidden by the burgeoning folds of flannel, but manly as a bull in the heat of summer. Emily's bosom had found itself perched above the level of the sheets. They were neat and starch, but not the bosom. It was in motion, trembling, like the sea, up and down. A heavy swell. There was a candle burning by the bed. He licked his forefinger and thumb, reached over and put out the light. Now they were free to wallow in the darkness. Mulholland screwed up his face in sudden consternation. No, wallow? Well, that couldn't be right. Hogs did such in mud. No, wallow was out of the question, and there couldn't be darkness, not with the lashings of moonlight. He shut his eyes tightly and brought his hands, palms together, up to touch his lips, as if in meditation. No, wallow and darkness were not permissible. Best concentrate on the moister, swelling aspects. What in God's name are you doing, Constable? The young man spun round, eyes opened, face flushed to meet the baleful scrutiny of his own and everyone else's appointed superior in Leith Police Station, Lieutenant Roach. No one would want him leaning over their bedside, not unless they were dead. The lieutenant's resemblance to a crocodile was nigh uncanny. Hooded membrane eyes, slightly bloodshot, a jaw full of large teeth that he often jerked from side to side, and a long snout, which at this moment was twitching in Mulholland's direction. And where is Inspector McLevy, if I may be so bold? Roach asked, his brooding gaze flitting round the room. He had, in truth, been rather perturbed to open the door and find his constable in commune, apparently, with the occult. He knew Mulholland for a staunch Protestant, if Irish, and hoped the young man was not being religiously undermined by the wave of mesmerism, spiritualism, psychic phenomena, and the like, sweeping the country. Had the Queen herself not been rumoured to have once taken part in a séance in order to contact her dearly beloved Albert? In Roger's view, the whole thing was nothing more than Catholicism in one of its many guises, such superstitious drivel concealing the sly tendrils of ultramontanism. Therefore, his eyes bore into Mulholland's, searching out a shift in belief. The inspector, replied the constable carefully, mentioned to me that he may be a little on the late side this morning. A personal matter, sir. Indeed. Must have slipped his mind to inform me. That's a mystery, sir. I know you are always foremost in his thoughts. What Mulholland did not add was that McLevy's aforesaid foremost thought was how to keep Roach from meddling in his investigations, but there was not a trace of this privy information on his candid countenance. The wave of love and desire that had swept through his vibrant organic parts was placed in restrainers for the moment. He was back to pragmatic self because he needed to have the lieutenant firmly in his corner, just behind Cupid. Roach sniffed in disbelief at the constable's response, and his eyes passed disdainfully over the station cubbyhole, where the rank and file hung their uniforms and left spare boots strewn in disarray. A smell of sweat hung in the air, mingling with the odours from the oft-used water closet next door. The mirror, now mercifully free from the image of the lovesick Mulholland, was set into the wall by the door and intended for the inspection of both uniform and boots before the leaf constabulary launched themselves upon the grateful populace to protect the righteous and hammer down upon the criminal classes. It had a large crack running haphazardly down its full length, the spider's web of smaller cracks off to the one side. This side was also discoloured with what looked like a lime-green mould, and for anyone who was not in love, as they gazed into the glass, the resultant image reflected was that of a personality lividly split in twain. Roach looked upon this duality and repressed a shudder. The one was bad enough to regard. Unlike most men, he was not fond of his appearance. God knows what Constable Ballantyne thought. Poor fellow being possessed of a birthmark, strawberry in colour that melted down half the span of his face. Mulholland stood by patiently, and Roach remembered he had come in to complain. "I am urged from my office," he said querulously, "to find the morning shift departed, Constable Ballantyne lost in admiration of the seagull droppings upon our window panes, and Sergeant Murdoch apparently in deep contemplation at the station register, but in fact resting fast asleep on the one elbow."
"I don't know how he does that," said Mulholland.
"The reward of inertia is inertia," Roach snapped, misquoting perversely the dictum of St. Augustine on patience. The place was empty. Empty of you, empty of McLevy, of direction, meaning, empty of life itself.
This seemed a bit dramatic to Mulholland, but Monday mornings can often appear so, vacant of purpose.
"I'm sure it will fill up again, sir. Crime never sleeps. That's what the inspector always says."
Roach grunted morosely at the proffered saw of consolation and seemed lost in gloom. He hunched over his clasped hands and moved them slowly back, then forward. Perhaps in that emptiness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.